Hey, listen, you guys ready to get in the Word of God today?
Yes, yes, yes.
Amen. All right. I'm glad a couple of you are. I'm going to pray. You're going to pray. Let's pray together. Just bow your heads and let's go before the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for tonight. We ask that you would speak to us out of your Word. Lord, I pray that it's not about me. It's not about my words, because my words are insufficient to make any difference in this world. But Lord, I pray that it's your Word that we get into today that makes a change in our lives. And so, Father, as we walk out of this place, we ask that you would just speak to each and every person right where they're at. Lord, help us to open our ears to hear and our eyes to see your word, your will, your desire for our life as we get into it tonight. In Jesus' mighty name, we all together said,
amen.
Amen. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to Luke, the 9th chapter, and put a ribbon in John, the 13th chapter. That's where we're going to go today. Luke chapter 9. John chapter 13. We're going to start in Luke chapter 9. We'll end in John chapter 13. So you can put a ribbon in John 13. Go to Luke chapter 9. A couple of years ago, I was invited by a pastor that I highly respect, that I look up to. Just really, really great guy. Just, you know, speaks to me and on my level of understanding. I relate to him on a certain level in a certain place. And I remember a couple of years ago, I got an invite. I actually called me personally, which was like, wow, how did you get my phone number? But he called me and he said, listen, I have this pastor's conference that I want you, and particularly you, I want you to come out to and be a part of. And I want you to come and, you know, being a second generation pastor and growing up in church as a, you know, we call them pastor's kids. We call them PKs, or minister's kids, missionary's kids, MKs. Being a PK, it's a unique thing that people who weren't raised in church don't quite grab a hold of the concepts and seeing life how PKs see it, because we see all the glitz and the glamour, but also the drama behind the scenes of church. And so he says, you know, I have a special thing for PKs that I want you to come and be a part of. And I'm like, okay, you know, cool. And he kind of just presented it as, you know, I'm thinking, all right, there's going to be a bunch of other people that are like second gen like me, you know, like we're going to talk about it. Like, man, you grew up, oh man, your parents didn't let you watch the Smurfs either. Mine, oh my God, how awesome. Like, I'm thinking it's going to be just this like relational connection. Like, wow, I didn't know that. I was, you know, I'm glad I'm not the only person that thought that or saw that or felt that, whatever. Right, you know, so I'm all excited, and there's this big dinner and talking about prime rib, and I want you guys to get together. All the PKs are going to get together in this room. All the other pastors are in this room, but all the PKs are going to get together, network, and just get to know each other, hopefully exchange phone numbers and just build relationships. And I'm like, cool, man, that sounds like fun. So I get there, I go to dinner, and I see all these pastors. I mean, and in this pastors conference, there's some guys that are just like heroes, man. I just like these, you know, I can say like this, like big dogs, you know. And I'm like, wow, man, these guys have done some things. And, you know, I'm excited. I'm hoping that maybe I could rub elbows with somebody, just kind of maybe like, you know, catch some of their cologne to take it home and be like, wow, I got some of that. I don't know. And so I go to the PK's dinner. And at the PK's dinner, they put me at this table. I'm kind of like the first one at the table. And I'm like, all right, who's coming? What do we know? Who's going to be there? And all of a sudden, all these kids start walking in. Like six-year-olds and like eight-year-olds. And like their nanny, like literally their nanny sat at the table. And I can see through the doorway, through the hallway, through like the main event center, is all these like pastors talking all things theological and great and mighty of God and what God has done in their life. And then I'm at the table with like eight-year-olds. And truth be told, I was just really upset. You know, I mean, I'm sure you've been there before where in some way it was probably totally unintentional. Somebody marginalized you. They overlooked you. They said something or did something or responded in a way that, you know, to their credit, totally did not mean it to go that way. But you just kind of like rose up and like just kind of, you know, it's amazing. You don't realize that you're living in it until all of a sudden it comes up, and then you're just like, hey, I'm better than this. And all of a sudden you start to think of like, well, I'm not going to come back next year. You try to call me, I can't wait for that invitation to come back my way. Give me the comment card of how it's going to go, and I'll share with you my comments of the conversation of the table of eight-year-olds. Sometimes we just kind of rise up, just kind of like the blood settles, it comes to the surface, you know. For us real pasty white people, we turn real red. For all the people blessed with pigmentation, you guys get to hide it a little bit better, praise Jesus. We just got the short end of the stick. But there's just something about it of like that, I'm better than this. I just, what you said about me, how you brushed me off, or how you treated me at the job, or what you said to me when I was, whatever it might be, we just kind of get that like, you know what, forget you. I'll show you. Anybody ever been there before? I think we've all been there at some point or another. You know, the thing is where does that come from? What is it about being marginalized? What is it about being overlooked? What is it about somebody misrepresenting or coming at you and thinking that you're just not what you are, and you kind of got to respond back and defend like, no, I am the bag of chips and all of that I said, and I think I am. Pride. It's pride, right? There's a sense of pride that's ingrained within humanity that just says, I'm better than that. I'm better than the legacy. You know, maybe you grew up in a family that said poor things or had bad things happen. I'm better than that. I'm better than that. Or maybe teacher said something about you growing up. I'm better than that. Maybe you failed, or maybe you made some mistakes, and you know, you just kind of stood up. I'm better than that. I'm not going to do that ever again. I will never make that mistake again. Man, what happens when we say stuff like that? You go right back to it, right? You make that mistake again. Today, I wanted to look at a story as I was reading. God's showing me things in my life that I'm dealing with on a constant daily basis that just thought I'd share with you tonight as we look at what the Word of God says about this subject. And I titled it, and well, you'll see why, because it doesn't really have anything to do with selfies, but the title is The Selfie Problem. And you say, well, Pastor Luke, I don't have a selfie problem. And I titled that because I was looking at pictures on my phone today. And if you have an iPhone, I don't know about Androids, I couldn't tell you that, but if you go to your photo library and you keep like clicking on albums till you get to the base albums, there's actually a category on your phone called selfies. And it's all the pictures you take of yourself. And I had 283 pictures of myself. And I thought, that's a problem. But that's not even what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about the selfie problem. And I had you turn to Luke in the 9th chapter. Luke in the 9th chapter, we're just going to see a real kind of interesting story. And there's a story here as Luke is recounting the story and the life of Jesus to a Gentile, to a Greek man. And Luke, the doctor, wrote a great portion, actually, if you count it by words, by how many words are written in the New Testament. Luke is one of the principal authors of the New Testament. And he writes and recounts Luke and Acts. And in Luke, he writes this story. And this is an amazing story because in Luke, the 9th chapter, something really amazing happens. Jesus takes his core, his close group of he had 12 disciples, but within that 12, he had a core. He had a close group of disciples. And he takes three of them, Peter, James, and John. And they go up to the top of this mountain. And on the top of this mountain, they see Jesus transfigured, which means they see that the shape and the image of who Jesus is literally change into this glorious image. And then they see Jesus talking to these figures in the Old Testament, and all of a sudden the cloud appears on the mountain, and the booming voice of God speaks to Peter, James, and John, and this is my son, listen to what he says. And Peter's like, oh my gosh, should we be here right now? I mean, they saw something amazing, and then they come down from that, and there was a right after that, they come into this place, and a man runs up to Jesus and he says, My son is possessed, and there's a demon that comes upon him, and he falls, and I'm afraid for his health. And your disciples, they tried to pray for him and cast this demon out, but they couldn't. And Jesus says, bring him to me. And so Jesus casts this demon out of this young boy. This major events within the Bible and within the life of the disciples. And then in Luke, the 9th chapter, after all this greatness we see, Peter confesses Jesus is the Christ, and there's all this amazing things. In the 46th chapter of Luke, the 9th verse, it says this, after all that, then a dispute rose among them. This is the disciples. As to which of them would be the greatest. Think about that for a moment. Think about that for a moment, right? I just love to be a fly on the wall. And I think it's Mark's account of this says that they were walking on the road debating. And Jesus comes back and asks them, hey, what were you all fighting about on the road? I can just imagine some shuffling and some jarring for position. And so here there's this debate, this dispute among them. And I could see the great, you know, the James and John, the sons of thunder, they're called. And I can see them say, well, listen, y'all tried to cast a demon out of the boy and couldn't even do it. But Jesus brought us to the Mount of Transfiguration. We saw Jesus. I heard the voice of, and they're talking about, because of that, I'm the greatest. Because of that, you're good, but you're not that. I'm I can just imagine Peter, like, you don't understand. I just professed Jesus, and he turned around and he blessed me and then rebuked me, but then I learned and I'm a new man, changed man in Jesus' name. And Peter says, I'm the rock. Petra, right? We look back at this and we look at them and we're like, you dummies. Do you realize you're arguing about who's the greatest in the kingdom of God in front of God? Right? And so here they argue and they're debating about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom. And look what it says. It says, and Jesus, perceiving the thought of their heart, takes a child and sets it by him. He takes a kid. A lowly little kid. See, what does a kid represent? A child represents status. They have no independence. They're completely reliant upon their parent for food, for sustenance, for shelter, for to live. They're independent, or they're dependent upon somebody else. They have no social status. They have no welfare. They have no well-being on their own. They're good for nothing. And Jesus takes a kid. And he brings him by him. I just think, you know, Jesus sets a little kid on his lap, squeezes him, tickles him on the ribs or something like that. And he says to the disciples, whoever receives this child in my name receives me. And whoever receives me receives he who sent me. For he who is least among you is greatest. So Jesus kind of drops this bomb on the disciples. They're arguing about who's going to have the best view in heaven. Well, you know what? You know, Jesus is going to talk about mansions and homes. And my mansion's going to be on the crystal sea in heaven. And I'm going to have a big balcony. And your mansion's going to be, you know, you're going to have this, they call it the city view. And or the courtyard view. I get the ocean view. And Jesus says, who is ever the least among you? Holding this kid next to him is the greatest in the kingdom of God. And he takes the status quo and he turns it upside down. And you know what the thing about it is? When we reflect on our lives and when you reflect on when somebody marginalized you, when somebody ostracized you, when somebody said something and you kind of just jumped up in your spin and said, I'm better than that. Jesus says, listen, whoever is least among you is the greatest. And even in the day of the disciples here in front of Jesus Christ as he walked on the earth, they dealt and deal with the same things that you and I deal with. You see, we're living, and they were living, in a selfie culture. Now, you say, Pastor Luke, that doesn't make any sense because the disciples did not have a phone, right? Phones are about 2,050 years away from being invented. They didn't even have like a tin can with a string, right? They had camels and horses and words, if that. That's all they had. So what do you mean by that? You think about what a selfie is. It's an image of you, right? I mean, you take a picture. I take a picture of a background. Some of my selfies were from our vacation when we took last year in Hawaii. And it's like, beautiful place, wonderful waterfall, lush green forest. And it's like, that picture didn't look good enough. So then I had to step in front of the picture and take a picture of me in the picture so that I could always remember that I was there. See, the context of the picture is not the picture. The context of the picture is me. And a selfie culture is not a culture of people that take pictures of themselves on phones. Who cares about how many selfies you have on your phone? The root of the issue is that humanity lives in a selfish consciousness. We're all thinking about it. We're all living. You say, Pastor Luke, I'm moved beyond that. If you're not living, if you say, I've moved beyond a selfish consciousness, then you're living in a deniable consciousness. Because ultimately, every person on earth wants to do exactly what the Constitution of the United States tells us that we have the rights and the liberty to do, and that's pursue happiness. We want a piece of the pie. The selfie generation, they call it, the millennials, all about themselves, the most narcissistic generation that has ever lived on the face of the earth is alive and beating today, growing at a crazy rate. But you see, every generation had their selfie. It may not have been a picture of themselves. It might have just been a white picket fence on a home and 2.5 children and a Cadillac. Might have just been a position, and it might have been just a nice home on the edge of the prairie. It might have just been a settlement. It might have just been freedom from opposition. Whatever it was, we have all, humanity, sought to improve our own lives for our own benefits. We live in a selfie culture. We are a selfie culture. We seek after our own benefits. And that's exactly the reason why when somebody says something to you, when somebody's wronged you, when somebody's hurt you, when somebody's overlooked you, when somebody not even knowing it in your own, you were wrong. Why? Because you stepped out with a selfie culture and said, I'm better than this. When Jesus looks at his disciples and says, you guys want to argue about who's got the best seat in heaven? Let me tell you who's got the best seat in heaven. The person that's lowest in the position has the best seat in heaven. And he takes that selfie culture and he turns it completely upside down. And sometimes we don't realize pride, how steeped we are in it. I remember having a phone conversation with mom about a year ago, a little bit under a year ago. She was just, her and I were crying about my pride, because I'm probably the most prideful person I know. And you're like, Pastor Luke, I'm the most prideful person that I know. It's like, hey, we have so much in common. Huh? Isn't that amazing? And the thing of the matter is that it's like humanity, we don't realize how deep pride goes because we're born into it. You don't see your own dirt. When you go to somebody else's house, you see the dust that settles on their furniture or their appliances, or you see the mess that's in the corner. But when you get to your own home, you don't notice it anymore. Why? Because it's yours. And sometimes we think, I'm doing well. I'm doing good with myself. I feel like I've gone beyond and I've moved on and I've moved up and I've let things go. But the truth of the matter is that as we attain understanding and knowledge, as we grow smarter, as technology allows us to do more, we find ourselves more productive. We only seem to grow. That's why you're seeing the most narcissistic generation on earth. We only seem as humanity to grow with more and more pride. It's deep. It's deep. But don't beat yourself up about it. Don't kick yourself. Why? Because the 12 people closest to Jesus Christ, in front of Jesus Christ, were arguing about position. And Jesus points us in the Bible and in His Word. He points us to the solution or the answer to the selfie problem. And that is this, that service to others is the answer to the selfie problem. Service to others is the answer to the selfie problem. I mean, look at the polarization of our nation. Look at where we're at with racial tensions. Look at where we're at in all these different areas and all these different issues of our world. We cry out and say, well, why doesn't the government do something? We cry out and say, God, why don't you do something? And God said, I sent my church to do something. But the problem is that the church, and I'm part of that, has a selfie mentality of what can God do for me. But the realization is that God doesn't exist for me. That's a hard realization to come into reality. That God doesn't exist for you, but rather you exist to glorify God. And sometimes people have a hard time with that. I don't want to clap to that. Why? Because my selfie. Nature doesn't like that idea that the sole purpose of my existence is to bring glory to something, someone, somewhere else. That's hard. And so Jesus points in His Word to the solution to the selfie problem, the problem of pride and selfishness within His own body, within His own collective group, within His own disciples, is the service to others. To elevate somebody other than myself higher than me. It's probably one of the hardest things in my life to do, but yet one of the most important things on earth I can do. Because the government's not going to solve our issues today. Listen, there's a presidential debate. I think it's tonight, right? Is it tonight?
Tomorrow night.
I'm real political. And we're looking to two candidates to solve our problems. Guess what, church? They're not going to solve your problems. We're looking to politicians. We're looking to lawmakers. We're looking to celebrities. We're looking to people with voices around the world to solve our problems. But you see, the problem will never be solved if the selfie culture is never addressed. Because everybody's going to seek after, it's my right. It's my privilege. It's my God-given ability to do this. Me. God, why don't you do something about my life? And God says, I didn't create you for you. I'm not created for you. You're created for me. And Jesus says, you want position in my kingdom. You want to do something in this world. You want to have a life that actually makes a difference. He says, look at the kid, look at the person that has nothing in life. And if you can accept them and you can receive them and you can do something for them, you can do something for me. As a matter of fact, in Matthew, it's a verse. It's not on the overheads. In Matthew, the 25th chapter, we were raised on this. This is the foundations of the church. Jesus is talking to his people and he says, you visited me in prison. You know, I was hungry and you gave me food. When I was naked, you gave me clothing. And then he says, they're going to come back and say, what are you talking about, Jesus? You were never in prison. You were never naked. You every time you were hungry, there was always food ready for you. And he says, when you did this to the least of my brethren, you did this to me. And you see, the solution, the answer to the selfie problem is a service of others. And I was listening to a pastor, a real famous pastor. I look up to the guy. There's just something about him. He's a younger guy. And I was listening to his story, and he was just saying, you know, people tell me I'm gifted, and people say this, and people say that. And he says, you know, it's not about giftedness. He says, you want to know why I am the way I am? And he says, because I have a hard time believing that the short time on earth, that I can sit back and do nothing and people are going to meet my king. And I can't live with the fact that I can't do anything about that. He says, while I'm here on earth, I'm going to do everything I can to help every person I can on their journey to meet my king. You see, a life is all about somebody else, not us. I think it was Dietrich Bonhoeffer that said the church exists for the service of others. And yet we come to church, and what church has become in America in this post-Christian era, church has become a social gathering where we come and to receive, well, you know what, I didn't get much out of what the pastor said to me today. And I didn't like what the worship was doing for me today. And I didn't like the song selection of what was going on for me. It didn't reach me today. But you see, the church, Jesus said when he talked to Peter, when I will build the gates this upon this rock, the revelation that I'm the Messiah and the gates of hell shall not prevent or not come against us. He wasn't talking about a social gathering. He was talking about a group of people that said, you know what, I'm going to take my life and I'm going to lay it down for the betterment of somebody else. I'm not going to worry about how good I have it here or in heaven. I'm going to do what God called me to do. And not only God called me to do what God told me to do, not only what God told me to do, what God showed me to do, not only what God showed me to do, what God came to this earth to exemplify for me to do. Because ultimately, Jesus Christ, the Bible says, did not count a robbery to be equal, came and took the form of a slave. You and I, slaves to sin, bought and brought in death, came to exemplify that his life was not about him. His life was about you and about me and about every other person that lives on this earth to redeem and to reconcile God to who they are. And the answer to the selfie problem is service to others. As a matter of fact, what's so funny about humanity is that we catch it and we lose it, and we catch it and we lose it, and we catch it and we lose it, and we catch it and we lose it. And that's why I say, you might look at yourself right now and say, I'm not dealing with pride. Until we're complete in Jesus Christ, we're human. Which means you're probably dealing with pride by saying you're not dealing with pride. Because I had you turn to Luke. Go with me. Let's just go. Just you want to have fun? You want to have fun with the disciples? Let's have fun on the account of the disciples. Can we do that tonight? Luke, the 22nd chapter. Go there. 22nd chapter. So This is not the same story. This is progressed. Time has progressed. Luke wrote this in a linear form. So this is later on in the ministry of Jesus. And Jesus is about to die. This is the night that Jesus is going to die, or be handed over to die, I should say. And here, they're preparing for the final, the Last Supper. They have the Last Supper, and there Jesus has done that, and the Last Supper's gone on. And verse number 24, it says this: "Now there was also a dispute among them as to which of them should be considered the greatest." Now there's some context and there's some clarity in the other gospel accounts of this story. Is you can't blame a mama looking after her kids, right? But James and John's mama comes, and James, John, come here. I'm going to go to Jesus and talk to Jesus and say, "Jesus, would you take my sons and make them the best in heaven? Thank you. I'm a mama. I want my kids to succeed in life." And of course, that probably stirs up some contention. And there's another thing. And he says to them, "Kings of Gentiles exercise lordship over the Gentiles, and those who exercise authority them are called benefactors. But it's not so among you. On the contrary, who is greatest among you, let him be as the younger. And he who governs, let him as serves." Once again, Jesus points it. You want to be the biggest? Be the lowest. You want to be the greatest? Be the less. You want the biggest position in the kingdom of God? Let go of yourself and do something for somebody else. "For he who is greater, he who sits at the table or he who serves? Is it not he who sits at the table? And yet I am among you as the one who serves." See, Jesus didn't just tell us to serve others. Jesus said, "I came to serve others." Jesus, "I saw creation of the world. I was there." I love it when he tells his disciples, "I saw the devil fall. I was there when that all happened. I saw him get booted out of heaven like lightning. I was there. I saw it. I saw the Red Sea." When they questioned Jesus and they said, "Well, who are you?" And he says, "Before Abraham, I am. I was there." Jesus says, "You think that I'm not the head of the table?" But yet Jesus says, "I came not as the guy sitting at the head of the table enjoying the luxuries of life." He said, "I have come as the one who serves." And every time the disciples battled with the selfie culture of pride and selfishness, Jesus points them to service of others to deal with the problem. The answer to the selfie culture is the service of others. To do something for somebody else. The question begs, how do I put somebody before me in a culture that glorifies me? Everywhere you go, it's about you. The car you're going to buy, it's about you. The phone that you carry in your pocket, it's about you. The clothes that you wear, it's all about express yourself. It's about you. The culture is all about you. So how do I elevate, how do I put somebody before me in a culture that elevates me as the best? Jesus gives us the example. He shows us how you turn there in John the 13th chapter. Had you put a ribbon there earlier, and so we'll go there now. In John the 13th chapter, every time the disciples dealt with pride, he directs them to service of others. And in John the 13th chapter, verse number 12, it says, when he had washed their feet, and this is an interesting story. Jesus has, before dinner, he gets there and he takes off his nice clothes, and he puts on work clothes, servant's clothes, and he has the disciples sit down, gets out a bowl of water, and he washes everybody's feet. And Peter's like, "Jesus, I am not worthy for you to wash my feet. I should be washing your feet." And Jesus says, "Peter, you want to be something in the kingdom? You better let me wash your feet." And Peter's like, "Jesus, give me a shower. All right? Like, just wash it all." And Peter's like, Jesus is like, "You don't understand what you're talking about." And so Jesus washes the disciples' feet. And think about this for a moment now. Maybe you've gone at any length of time in your life without wearing socks. Your feet stink. They had leather shoes. They didn't wear Toms. They didn't have breathable Nikes. They didn't have running shoes. They had leather sandals, which meant the dust of the land was on their feet. The weeds, their toenails. They didn't have toenail clippers. Think about that for a minute. The dust from the ground was under their toenails. And here's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Son of God, on his knees in servant's clothes, washing the feet of his disciples. And it says it like this. It says that when he washed their feet, verse number 12, taking his garments, and he sat down again, he says to them, "Do you know what I did to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say well, because that's what I am. If I am then your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, then you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you." He says, verse 16, "Most assuredly I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who sent greater than he who sent you. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." Blessed are you if you do them. See, the answer to the selfie culture is the service of others. And how do I put somebody else above me in a culture that lifts me up above all others? Today, I thought, you know what, maybe I could give you three crafty, cunning things that you might remember. Or I could just take what Jesus said and just tell you to try it. And so maybe you're like me. Maybe you look at the face of a problem and you say, the problem is so big, so overwhelming, so grand, I don't even know where to start. I don't even know what to do. Pastor Luke, I recognize and I realize that there are areas of my life that pride has held me back. It's amazing to see what pride is capable of in our life, but Jesus came to show us what we are capable of through him. And so maybe you're like me and you look at something like that. You look at the problems of the world. You look at the problems of your life. You look at the relationships that you're in and you wonder, how do I even start? You don't understand what I'm going to go home to with my husband or my wife. You don't even know what I'm going to go back to in my job tomorrow. You don't know the circumstances of where I'm at right now or the monotony or the mundane of my life and day in and day out. I don't even know where to start to make a difference in my life. And Jesus simply just says this. If you know what to do and you do it, you'll be blessed. So what I thought we could do tonight, since Sunday night's kind of like our Bible study night, it's our intimate service and we're all gathered. I thought what we could do as a church, collectively, is conduct an experiment on the Word of God. Would anybody be willing to try something in the Word of God? A couple of you? Would anybody be willing to try something? If you don't want to try it, don't raise your hand. I'm serious. Oh, dang, look at you. You're like, well, I'm not raising my hand until you tell me what it is. Because if you're talking about washing somebody's stank, nasty feet, I'm not sure I want that position in heaven right now. Well, okay, I'll let the pressure off of you. How about this? Let's try something. From today until Sunday, 7 days, every day this week, find an opportunity to serve somebody else in the name of Jesus. Let's conduct an experiment in our lives. You say, Pastor Luke, I do that. I do that. I'm in the service industry. Pastor Luke, I'm in ministry. Pastor Luke, I'm a mother. I serve. How about this? Each day this week, serve someone unexpectedly in the name of Jesus. So if you're already in the service industry, that don't count. So if you work at Chick-fil-A and somebody says thank you and you give them an extra sauce and you say, my pleasure, that doesn't count. That's expected. Each day this week, serve somebody unexpectedly in Jesus' name. You see, sometimes we look at such big problems, we don't even know where to start. So why don't we do this? Why don't we start small and try something and see what it does? Not for the person, but for your selfie culture. What's the area that you're in? I would venture to say the area that you're dealing with, serve somebody in that area unexpectedly. Try it. Try it. Try it. In Matthew, the 10th chapter, Jesus says these words. He says, whoever gives, he's talking to kids again, the little folk. Whoever gives one of these little ones, listen to this, look what Jesus says. It doesn't have to be big. Whoever gives one of these little ones only a cup of cold water in the name of a disciple, I say assuredly to you, he shall no means lose his reward.
Sometimes we look at church. We say, well, you know what? I'm not gifted enough to be up on the top of the pulpit to change somebody's life. I'm not educated enough to make a difference in the kingdom of God. I'm not special enough. I've got too many issues in my life. I've got too many problems. Pastor Luke, I got 99 problems in my life, and a cup of cold water ain't one of them right now. But Jesus says, listen, don't go so far on the problem that you overwhelm yourself. Start small. Give somebody a cup of cold. You say, Pastor Luke, I don't know what to do. I don't know. Pastor Luke, what are you saying? I'm not quite sure what you're trying to say. Let me just boil it down if you really can't get it. Go to the supermarket and buy 7 Fiji waters. Good waters. Don't buy no Arrowhead, all right? I'm serious. Get the smart water. Get the one with the nice bottle. Get that Voss water that's like really expensive. Get the one that's in the water. Spend the money on 7 water bottles and put them in your fridge. And every day take one of them out of your fridge and give it to somebody that would not expect you to hand them a cold glass of water. For 7 days, every day this week, serve somebody unexpectedly in the name of Jesus. Because so often we get overwhelmed with the problems that we don't even know where to start. So what do? We don't do anything. And then we look at the issues of society. We look at where our nation's at. We look at where the world's going and say, God, why don't you do something? And God says, why don't you start somewhere? Because you see, the church of Jesus Christ, the body, you and I, we are the answer to the world's problems. Pastor Luke, Jesus is the answer, absolutely. And you and I are the vessels that carry the presence of God to the world, which means we are the answer. Jesus Christ already came and died. He did everything he needed to do. We're the vessels of delivery to the world, but yet we gather together and we're so stuck in a selfie culture, we don't know what to do. So let's just try something. To do something for somebody else, because every time the apostles and the disciples rose up in pride, Jesus directed them back to the service of somebody else. Start somewhere. Start somewhere. Why? Because church, whether we like it or not, Christianity, the idea of church, is growing less and less popular in our country. The fastest religious affiliation in the United States, the fastest growing religious affiliation, is a group called the nuns, and they're not Catholic. They're people who are unaffiliated with any religious organization altogether. Why? Because the church has been just like the disciples, arguing over position. Well, our church is better than this church, and down the street, they're not doing what we're doing, and over here across the world, And instead of focusing on what somebody else's position is, the church should be doing what the church should be doing, and that is serving somebody else for the glory and the goodness of God. September 22nd, 2016. Whether you agree with it or not, this is a decree from our government's institution. The phrases religious liberty and religious freedom will stand for nothing except hypocrisy so long as they remain code words for discrimination, intolerance, racism, sexism, homophobia, Islamophobia, Christian supremacy, or any form of intolerance. Martin Castro, the chairman of the United States Commission for Civil Liberties, wrote that this September 22nd. Whether we agree with it or not, the world is not seeing the church the way God created the church to be seen. Which means there's something that the church, and I'm not talking about a building with lights and electricity and sound and musicians. I'm talking about you and me. Which means the church needs to do something that the church has not been doing, and that is serving somebody else. Why? Because God does not exist for you. You and I exist for God. We exist for God. So try it. Try it for a week and see how you feel. Pastor Luke, what if they don't like me? Pastor Luke, you don't understand what's going on there. Have you ever heard the phrase, and I'm going to finish on this, people who live in glass houses shouldn't throw rocks. You ever heard that before? It's talking about hypocrisy. So funny that hypocrisy is also a word in so many cases synonymous with Christianity. So they say people who live in glass houses shouldn't throw rocks. Maybe, just maybe, what the church, you and I, the Christians, the followers of Jesus Christ, should grab a hold of that is that maybe instead of picking up stones for what somebody else is doing in the world, we should pick up a bottle of Windex and clean somebody's window. Because you know what the truth of the matter is? That nobody on earth will ever be perfected until they find Jesus Christ in heaven. That we're on a journey together, and which means, listen, which means me, my friend Pastor Dan, my dad Pastor Jim, some of the greatest preachers across the world are just like you, trying to figure things out in life day by day. And maybe we ought to stop picking up rocks and pick up a bottle of Windex, because isn't that, and if you know anything about the Bible, isn't that kind of what Jesus told the Pharisees when they dragged the woman out of her house being caught in the middle of adultery? And they had rocks in their hand ready to throw at them. And he says, those of you who don't have any sin, why don't you go ahead and throw that stone? Basically saying, you know what, maybe you ought to clean the windows of your glass house before you start throwing rocks at somebody else's. You see, pride is something that's inherent in every human being. Why? Because it's born into sin. And because it's born into sin, we're born into it, and we're deep into it. But Jesus Christ came and exemplified what life could be like, what the world would be like. And I refuse to believe that, despite what the world is seeing, that the first century church had no concept of the phrase religious freedom or religious liberty. The first century church was accustomed to being dragged out of their homes and stoned. The first century church, the people that you read about in the book of Acts, were accustomed to their friends and their families being dragged out and used as spectacles in arenas. They were accustomed to meeting in sewers and in caves and in grave sites because they couldn't meet in the public. Yet, despite what they were going through, somehow, some way, miraculously, they changed the face of the earth because they heard and saw what Jesus did to serve others, and they got that concept. Despite being marginalized, despite being overlooked, despite being hurt, despite being wounded, would you have the guts to try to serve somebody this week unexpectedly in the name of Jesus? Imagine. It's amazing that we read reports of people that won't serve police officers lunch because of the tension that's going on around the world. Can you imagine, instead of refusing to serve a police officer lunch, buying them lunch instead? No, good. Can you imagine that person at work that drives you nuts, instead of ignoring them and avoiding them, bringing them a coffee in the morning? Can you imagine, in the midst of the tension and the turmoil of your relationship at home, doing something out of the ordinary that you've never done before? And when that person comes and says, what are you trying to do? Say nothing and walk away. Think about that for a moment. What division would that bring? What tension would that bring? You know what the division it would bring is? It would divide you from your pride. That's the division it brings. It divides you from the selfie culture that you and I are born into. And it brings unity to the body of Christ. This week, simple, try it. You know what? You say, Pastor Luke, I already do it. Well, try something else. Try a little harder. Do something big. Try it. You know what? And if you go through the course of this week and you say, man, that was amazing to see what God has done in me through that. Imagine what it'll do if you do it for more than a week. Imagine what it'll do if you do it for a month, if you do it for a year. Imagine what God will do in your life if you do that for the rest of your life. Because look what Jesus says at the end of the statement when he washes his disciples' feet. Jesus says these words. He says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, you love one another. And I love this statement in verse number 35. By this, all will know you are my disciples. It's not the label that you wear. It's not the cross you have around your neck. It's not the fact that you attend church on a regular basis. Jesus says, if you do something for somebody else like I did for you, the world will know who you are and what you stand for. The answer to the selfie problem is a service of others. Would you try it? Now that you know, would you try it?
Yes.
Every day this week, do something unexpected. Maybe start at home. Start with somebody at the job. Buy somebody a cup of coffee at Starbucks. in the drive-thru. Don't leave your name. Don't leave your... Don't... Listen, don't go preaching at somebody. Why? Because they're expecting you to do that.
Yeah.
Serve them. Serve them. See what happens with that. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you, and Lord, we thank you for your word. It's challenging. It's convicting. It's hard. Maybe we wanted to come and get encouraged, not challenged, but thank you that your word is right. Your word is true. And ultimately, your word leads us to a better place. So, Father, I just ask that as we hear that, as we mull on that today, go home tonight, Lord, I pray that you would present opportunities for us, your church, your people, your body, to serve somebody unexpectedly in your name, whether it just be to give somebody a cold glass of water or be to do something big for somebody that we know needs something big, without an agenda, without preaching at somebody, but just to share your love with them. Lord, I ask that your Holy Spirit would minister to us every day this week as we do so. Show us, reveal to us, like the psalmist David said, search my heart, reveal to me, show me my issues. Lord, as we step out in the service of others, I pray that you would reveal to us the things in our heart that you want to do changes in and allow us to do so in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You know how this church got started? You know what set this church apart from every other church, hundreds of other churches in the Inland Empire? Not to say that one's better than the other, but you know what made us different? A couple of ladies, I see them on the front row, took a couple of bags of beans and rice to some people in a city where people had nothing and just said, here you go. It wasn't big, wasn't massive, it's insignificant. But it did something. It planted a seed and it started something. Now this is a church that feeds 500,000 people a year. You see, that cold glass of water you try this week might revolve and become something great in your life, a completely new opportunity, just like you saw in that testimony today. But it starts by doing something for somebody else today. Before we leave, I just want to give you the opportunity to examine your heart, to examine your life. I talked earlier this night about the hope of salvation. You know, one thing that is heartbreaking about Christianity in America and religion in America is that it's based on a lot of assumptions and pretenses. And I don't want you to walk out of this place today based on an assumption, based on a pretense. I want you to walk out of this place based on fact and the Spirit of God in your life and the truth of the Word of God. Today, before we leave, I want to give you the opportunity to look at your heart, to look at your life, to examine yourself, to see where you stand with God. In just a few moments, I want to give you the opportunity to take that step of faith and to examine yourself. I want to ask you this question. If you were to leave tonight and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? The question's simple, but the solution and the answer is sometimes so difficult to find. Because we come at all sorts of different arrangements, we come at all sorts of different conclusions, but let me just say this, how you come about your conclusion says so much about your position and your place with God. You see, nowhere in the Word of God, nowhere in the writings that were preserved over thousands of years, does it say that because you are a good person, because you be good and you do good, that it's going to be all good between you and God. Nowhere does it say that because you have good thoughts, because you try to do good things, because you try to maintain a positive life, that you do self-help and you want to be a you know, glass half full type person. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that means that you're okay with God. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, listen to this, nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend church on a regular basis, because you hear the pastor preach, because you raise your hands in a praise and worship song, or because you volunteer in the children's ministry. No one in the Bible does it say that because you went to church and you were christened or baptized as a baby, because you made a commitment, because you got a card in your wallet to an organization or a church group, denomination, whatever it might be. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that that's going to get you into heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say? Because you give yourself the title Christian, well, Christians go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you give yourself the title of Christian? That means you're going to be right with God and that everything's going to be good with you and God. You're going to find yourself in eternity with God in heaven forever and ever. You can't find that in the Bible. So often I hear, especially in this day, with people growing more and more unaffiliated with church, you know what, Pastor Luke, I believe that there's some truths to it. I believe that there's some good things said in that, but I feel like there's a bigger answer out there, and I believe in some form of spirituality and that there's a God out there. And, you know, we all kind of find our way as long as we all try to do the best we can. But can I tell you something? The Bible is very clear that all roads don't lead to heaven. Jesus says it like this. He says that he is the way, the truth and the life. And he says, no one goes to the Father in heaven except through him. There's no other way. It's not about positive thinking. It's not about karma. It's not about all these different things. I'm going to come back as a frog and a log or a dog. It's not about that. You see, Jesus is the hope of salvation. The Bible says that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. And no other way do we find God except through Jesus Christ. In the book of John, in the third chapter, Jesus is speaking to a religious man, Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a religious man. He memorized scripture. Nicodemus gave. He had a life of service to others in the form of religion. And Jesus, when he's having a conversation with Nicodemus, he says these words. He says, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, what is an inheritance? Inheritance belongs to somebody within. In order to be within the family, within the kingdom of God, he says, you must be born again. What does it mean to be born again? Our society, our culture, Hollywood, it's made a mockery out of that. You think of weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. But listen, let me tell you something. From the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word, it's always meant the same thing. In the heart and the eyes of God. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. I said that challenging statement today that God does not exist for you. You exist for God. And the only way to fulfill the existence of your life is to give your life in service to Jesus Christ with your heart and with your life. The book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church, a group of religious people gathering together, congregation. He says, listen, I know your works. I know what you're doing. He says, I'm coming back and I'm returning. And when I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot or I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because I find that you're lukewarm, somewhere in the middle. He says, I will vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus. And what he's saying is that lukewarm Christians will be rejected and ejected out of the kingdom of God. What does it mean to be lukewarm? Simply put, it means that you not wholehearted for God, you're not wholehearted against God, you're kind of somewhere in the middle, occasional church attendance, token prayer, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing, kind of dealing with the selfie culture, kind of trying to do what you can. Listen, God's not interested in your religion, he's interested in your relationship and the status of your relationship with him. And Jesus says, I want you to be all in. God forgive us in American churches that we've been so interested and invested in numbers and in the positions of people in seats that we've forgotten, neglected to tell people the truth about their position and place with God. But today, I love you enough, I respect you enough to tell you today the truth today, to challenge you with a message about pride. Say, you know what? Listen, it's okay to not have it all together. None of us have it all together, but Jesus does, and Jesus is the answer to all of our issues in life. And it comes by surrendering our heart, by surrendering our life to Jesus Christ with it all, a wholehearted commitment to him. Jesus says these words. He says, if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. He says, if you deny him, he'll deny you. Today, I want to give you the opportunity to receive the gift of salvation by accepting Jesus Christ today as your Lord and Savior. And here's what I'm going to do in just a moment. I'll count to three. I'll go one, two. And on the count of three, I'll go three. I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And when I do, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. See, what you're doing by the raising of your hands, you're saying, you know what? I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Pastor Luke, what you're talking about today, man, I feel like you were talking right to me. I feel like there's some things in my life that I just need to address. I feel like there's some things that I need to surrender and give over to God. Listen, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. I'll put it right back down. I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm here to build you. But it comes today by making a decision. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to make a decision to follow Jesus with all of my heart, with all of my life today. Who should raise your hands today? If you've never given him your heart, you've never given him your life, if that's you in just a moment, get ready. If you're not sure, man, that's the worst place to be in. Why? Because God did not send Jesus Christ to die on a cross so that you could walk around life with the lights off, hoping that you might find solid ground or you might find the right answer. Literally, God sent Jesus Christ to turn on the light in your life, to show you the clarity of where you are and where you stand. Do not walk out of this place today without knowing who you are and where you stand with Jesus Christ. And we can fix that today by making a decision to follow after Jesus. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, if you've been playing the church game, coming on Sundays, doing your own thing, listen, come on. If that's you today, let's make the decision today to go full-hearted with God for Jesus Christ. To surrender your heart, to give your life to Jesus Christ. It starts today by making that decision to walk out of this place with a hope of salvation, knowing that your best days are yet to come. But that only comes through the gift of Jesus Christ. Shortly after you raise your hand, we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together. We're going to do that all together. And what you're saying is, I want to make the decision, Pastor Luke, include me, count me in on that prayer because I want to be a part of it. I'm a man, I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge it, you can put it right back down, and we'll go forward together all across this auditorium from the front row, back row, side to side, even if you're watching on the live stream or on the closed circuit television, wherever you're at, this is your moment, this is your time. The day of your salvation is today to give your heart, to give your life to Jesus Christ. I'm going to count to three, and when I do, if that's you in this place, the Spirit of God speaking to you, pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, and put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. You ready? I'm going to count to three, and if that's you, this is your moment. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. If that's you, pop your hand up so I can see it. Where are you at in this place today? I see you right there. I see you right there. I see you right there. Anybody else in this place today say, man, I wonder if I should. Yeah, they did it. You can too. That's you in this place today. Say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on. I see you right there. Good. I see you up on the front. In the family rooms, if that's you, I see camera operators pointing. I see you guys right there. Good. Both of you. I see you. Anybody else, you say, man, I wonder if I should. The Spirit of God speaking to you right now, knocking on your heart. Are you going to answer? I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. I see you guys. I see you right there. Anybody else in this place today? Anybody else in this place? There are about 9 people, I think, about somewhere in there. Anybody else? Where are you at, number 10? Say, man, I wonder if that's me. Yeah, that's you. Your turn to respond. Anybody else today? Let's give the Lord a great big praise for about 9 people raising their hands today. Great. I said we're going to pray a prayer of salvation, and we're going to do that together right here, right now. And here's what we want to do. We want to equip you. We want to connect you. We want to build you up. So if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, here's what we're going to do. In just a moment, we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together. And I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, or friend if you need a friend. If you came with a family member or somebody came with you, look at them and say, come on, will you go with me? Look at them and say, I'll go with you. Come on, let's go together. I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come and meet me right here at this altar. We're going to pray together. We're going to change destinies together right here. We're all going to stand as we do. Elijah, my friend's going to sing a song. And if that's you in this place, you raise your hand. Come on, come meet me up here. Let's follow through with that decision to give your life to Jesus. Let's change destinies together right here, right now. If that's you, come on, you come.
Lay down your shame. And all who are.
Yeah, you come, if that's you.
Lift on your face. The whole world to come. You're not too far.
They're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you. If that's you, if the Spirit of God's drawing you home, come on. This is your moment. This is your time. Awesome. They're still coming. Come on, you're worth waiting for. You're worth it.
Come as you are. Come as you are.
Well, praise God. Hey, you guys came. I'll tell you what, everything's going to change today. Everything's going to change. Why? Because you're making the best, most wise decision you can as a human being. I mean, that is monumental. Good job. Good job. Here's what we're going to do together. We're gonna pray. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. Listen, God doesn't listen to the words of your mouth like abracadabra, magical phrase, and all of a sudden everything's good. God listens to the prayers of your heart. So I'm going to say a couple of words. I'm going to ask you just to repeat them after me. We're going to pray together. You're going to invite Jesus to come into your heart, come into your life. So if you miss a word, you change a word, it's all good. Just listen, let it be out of your heart today. Let's all join together and let's pray together a prayer of salvation. I'm going to ask everybody in this place to join with me tonight. If you're at home and you made that decision to follow Jesus, you can pray right now too. But let's all bow our heads, close our eyes, and go one more time and go before the Lord and pray. Repeat these words after me today. Father God, I come to you today, and I need you. And I recognize that. Today, I commit my life to you. I give my heart, I give my life to Jesus Christ. I recognize that Jesus died for my sins. And today, I accept his salvation. I'm a Christian. I'm leaving my past behind. Cleanse me of my sins. Bring me into a new future. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, good job, guys. So easy. Here's what I want to do really quickly. Listen, we don't want to leave you empty-handed. We want to get you connected. And for you guys, we even got a comic book just for you, okay? We want to get some stuff into your hands. So see this guy right over here waving at you in his deep V, man, slick-looking guy. Pastor Joel, just a stud of a man. He's going to take you right over there. Nothing weird goes on. I'm the weirdest guy you will meet at this church, okay? You made it past me. He's going to give you some free information. He's going to introduce you to a friend, somebody that's going to get you connected here. And if you need prayer, they're going to pray with you tonight, okay? Just want to just love on you, just point you in the right direction for your future. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over with my friend, Pastor Joel. Praise God.